I always had this gift of melodies. And clothing these beautiful melodies with messages that are really more close to people who wants to hear more about something that will heal them.
Words to that voice, it just may, you know, it'll make you cry, it'll make you laugh, it'll make you dance, make you sing.
He is one of the most likable, lovable people.
Vusi Mahlasela symbolizes a lot of hope, forgiveness, all sort of the right buzzwords that are making South Africa a better place.
But inevitably he's moving people to tears wherever he goes, and that's just a beautiful thing to see. It's totally inspirational.
Wherever he goes, he just wants to see happiness, people smiling. The moment he steps on stage and plugs in his guitar and strums a few chords and so on, and he starts opening his mouth, you already know him.
I now stop singing of love. Now that my memory is surrounded by blood, sister, why, oh why, do we at times mistake a pimple for a cancer? La, 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 la.
Vusi, his mother passed away when he was still very young. And Vusi has been raised by his grandmother.
The first time I was being in love with music or inspired by music, it was during my earliest, you know, days. I was around 5-6 years old, because my grandmother owned a shebeen, of which it was illegal at that time. There used to come quite a lot of characters there. And there was this man who used to come singing at the backyards, the a cappella range form of music, like the mbube type of music.
He was just a small boy going around entertaining people, using his homemade guitar. He used to make guitars with tins.
I had a band with my friends. We had self-made instruments. I built up my first guitar using fishing lines and the container that used to contain what we call acha, Indian mango salad. You play that guitar with fingers and a stick, and it's sort of muted like a piano with a stick, putting a rubber band on top.
We usually enjoyed his playing music, and we always encouraged him because he could sing, he could dance.
My voice was like really special. And then the teacher was like, no, I want you to take the lead of that girl, you know, who's singing the lead, whatever, and you do it. And at the competition, our choir was always winning, because in other choirs, it was always a girl who was leading that song.
When he was young, he sang like girls. Yeah, he had that sweet, sweet voice. With, you know, he usually pitched very high.
I also learned that my father used to have a guitar. I didn't know my father. I only met, you know, my paternal roots in 2000 when I was looking for my father. And when I thought that I found him, he was buried 6 months before. My mother, who It was very much spiritual, and at some point had to undergo the Sangoma rituals as well. So there was a lot of music in the house and the beating of the drums of the Sangoma, you know, when they performed the Sangoma rituals and everything, and much more of the ancestral music as well. So I played a bit more of those drums and knew the songs, so there was quite a lot of music in my upbringing. So yeah, music was just something that really gave me strength all the time.
Well, I met Vusi when he was very young, when the Congress of South African Writers, our writers' organization, existed. And I was one of the people who used to run workshops. So he would come to poetry workshops and even to ordinary fiction ones. He was rather shy. Everybody else would be talking away, interrupting one another, and he just sat there quietly listening, and you'd have to draw him out. You'd have to say, well, Vusi, you know, what do you think? And then you would get a very carefully thought out and measured response. It was clear that among the young people who were in these workshops, he was exceptional. He really had something in his quiet way, and what he wrote, his lyrics, were really very good.
She opted to pay for my music lessons, and I was very much happy. So she was more like a mother to me.
He's very much a self-taught person, which very often is the best way. But I suppose with music, maybe you need to go a little further. And there was a woman down the road from here, I forget her name, who indeed was a guitar teacher. And so I can't remember whether it was through me or whether it was Kosal generally, but we did link up for him with her, and he began to go and take a few formal lessons. We became friends, and I was very, very interested in his progress, and then he would come and play the guitar and sing, and I was absolutely enchanted with it.
Unknown grave, the one who died maintaining his night. His will been so strong and musically inclined. His sad melodies coming out like a smoke from the woody fire. And he sang, my boo, Africa, sing now, Africa, sing loud, sing to the people.
I think I came to realize that no, something was not right about my country when 1976 came. I was very young, I think around 11 years time. You know, hell break loose in the townships, you know, smoke, fire, and I raised my eyebrows and I asked questions, what was happening? That's when my political education started. First time when I saw somebody performing poetry or had poetry, it was also during these political, you know, platforms, where I saw these people who were reciting. Someone was reading and the others were playing drums. I didn't understand what was happening, and I asked, what are they doing? I said, no, he's reciting poetry and they're doing it over a background of music. That is why that one is playing drums and all that. Wow, I like that, you know. I think, and I want to be part of that.
His protest against apartheid and against racism indeed was in his songs, in his lyrics, and in the way that he presented himself. All was this wonderful range between sometimes almost anger and great tenderness.
Also talking about how it is now time for people to roll up their sleeves and rebuild the society that had been destroyed, crashed. Always offering hope, always positive, highlighting some, you know, negative stuff. And even then also working in messages of, you know, Pan-African and stuff, not just South Africa or Mamelodi or how people. Uma bengavumisi ukubaveza nezenzo zabo ezimbi zemvelo. At the time, the country was going through a lot of turmoil. You know, Vusi was coming out with saying, guys, there's hope. Let's learn forgiveness. And this was, you know, long before the TRC days. So very interesting that he had his finger right on the pulse. Bahambela enqenye njengezinkalankala.
So ubuhle bomhlaba, meaning the beauty of our country or our land, was more about the beauty of our country, but also about the brutality that we saw from the police during the time of the struggle. That ugly face, you know, of the brutality from the police playing with our dead corpses, thinking that we don't know about this. And here in this song or poem, we're saying we will call them and teach them about those corpses. If they agree, we will forgive them. But if they don't, we will expose them. There is wisdom in forgiveness, you know. And this is more of the teachings that we did also get from some of our, you know, great leaders like Bishop Desmond Tutu, who preached more about the wisdom of forgiveness also. Tata Nelson Mandela, who planted the seed of reconciliation as well. That there is wisdom in forgiveness. If you forgive, you learn more to release more calmness within the innermost of yourself, and you become much more free.
And as the political situation moved and evolved, so his lyrics went along with it. He interpreted people's inner feelings about what was happening.
It was more like a borrowed fire from God, burning only unwanted things. There's to be more like a controlled field fire burning.
His songs, you know, they talk about what is happening around us every day.
Well, I think he was more inspired about the social life of people here in South Africa.
You can feel when the guys sing, you know, you will feel that pain also.
When I first heard Vusi's music, it was the only music that I'd ever heard by a South African artist that literally made me weep. It was just the most amazing music I'd ever heard, and I just couldn't believe I was lucky enough to be working with a guy like him.
All the songs, not all of them, in some way they have to sort of like red cloth that kind of subject about the problems that we are having in the country and giving hope, you know, to the people in some way. I heard such other songs like Tonkana, whereby was playing with parables in some way, just like Jesus Christ taught with pictures.
It's his development of music as an expression of who we are and what we are and how we live.
A lot of his lyrics are very profound. Through them being so profound, they're quite hard-hitting.
It's truly his inner expression that you get. And that is what is really so striking.
He doesn't want to sing just to sing. You can sing any words. You can say, oh, la, 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 la. Vusi doesn't do that. He planned everything. Every lyrics he planned.
Donkana, it's the name of a person. It means small donkey. But Donkana was this shepherd who was very much versed with the law of the jungle. He could imitate birds, read animal tracks. He was a good shepherd. The flocks, they understood him. When I did that song, it meant more to say, we need to have leaders who are more like shepherds, you know? Like the likes of Tata Nelson Mandela, Albert Luthuli, and the Pequots.
Although it is often quite hard-hitting in a socio-political way, it's never strident. It's not full of clichés, the same old slogans trotted out, you know. How shall I put it? He doesn't have to rap.
You put in your heart, then you'll see, you don't, you'll listen something, say, no, this guy was talking the truth.
You can lock the people, force them to exile and everything, but when the mass is like really tired, say that this is enough, hell will break loose.
I met Vusi in 1994. We just opened the baseline. I was very excited about having him at the baseline because of his relation to what we were going through in 1994 with the elections and everything. And he was personally for me quite symbolic of becoming free. It was very, very exciting. I spoke to BMG Records, who signed him up, and we organized a gig. And I remember when he sang When You Come Back, I was sitting with a whole bunch of plates of food in my hand, and I just sat there and stood there and froze, because it was just the most unbelievable thing to have him singing that track. And we'd only been free for like 4 or 5 months. It was very, very exciting.
The first one that I sort of like really recorded, when I had like, oh, is this really me singing? It was When You Come Back. So there was these people who were doing a documentary film about the exile people living in London or many other places outside South Africa, expressing their fears if they come back home, whether they will find their families or find jobs and things like that. And when they had me singing this song, performing When You Come Back, and it was just perfect.
When You Come Back, recorded by Lloyd Ross, Shifty Records, a legend in the South African industry. Lloyd had come to Vusi via some filmmakers who were doing a documentary on South Africa, and Vusi was doing some songs for the documentary, and Lloyd heard Vusi singing, recorded some demos and did the debut album When You Come Back. And Vusi, up until then, was really just known as a poet, a guy who was standing up at political rallies with other poets and other writers and reciting poetry. That album is a classic. I mean, that's the only way to describe it. It's a South African classic. It encapsulates a period of time in our history, you know, in 12, 13 songs, that is just phenomenal. But those songs, Vusi had been building those songs for years and years and years, and chipping away and refining. And I think Lloyd captured that beautifully on the recording, and just happened to be some of the best musos in the country.